Welcome to the Secret Underground Laboratory Recovery and Salvage, where rude mechanicals do magic.
Hello, I'm Bronze Age, director of the Secret Underground Laboratory Recovery and Salvage. And today we're going to be inspecting this wooden Empire style floor lamp and rewiring it as well. Starting at the bottom, this looks like the original plug, but I don't think this is the original cord. I can see that when they installed it, they just put the bare wires underneath the screw and they've gotten all twisted and pulled out. That's not a good way to do it. Also, this is an SPT2 cord, which compared to an SPT1, you can see the difference in size. Now, the wires on the inside are actually the same size. The difference is there's more insulation on this piece. And so you'll see it more often on floor lamps where, of course, the cord's going to be on the floor and more subject to getting abrasions and cuts and that sort of thing. Now, as we move up the lamp, we see one socket that's original and one that's obviously not. And one of the cool things about this is this little acorn finial on the end of the chain. It's a shame they didn't save that and put it on the new socket when they replaced it. Now, in the Secret Underground Laboratory, I like to do things the easy way, which in the case of floor lamps means finding a way to hold it so that you can comfortably work on it. And I see a big problem right here. Well, whatever tape was used when they replaced this part of the cord, it has long since disappeared, but I don't even see a trace of any kind of adhesive or something. I'd hate to think somebody actually just put this together, twisted it, and then stuck it up in there. But that's what it looks like they did. Now, there's no big surprises on this end. Of course, this is a replacement, and this socket here is not original. This one on this end is. I can tell that because of the porcelain body here. And of course, this is also the original wiring. And what we're going to do is replace both socket interiors, find a better match for the rest of the lamp, and put it all back together. Now here we can see the reason that I know that this cord is not the original. It's just too big. This piece of pipe is known as 1/8 inch iron pipe, 1/8 IP, and that's what it looks like. So as you can see, this cord's simply not going through there. This goes back to the days of gas lights. This is the smallest piece of pipe used for lighting in the house. And as electric lights came in, they continued using the thread and the size of the pipe. If you take a modern lamp apart today, that's what you're going to find inside of it. Now, floor lamps that were intended to have this size cord had one size up on the pipe, which was a quarter inch. But we're going to go back with the original size, which was the SPT1. Now, I'm going to use the old wire to fish the new wire through. And to make sure I don't lose it halfway through, I'm going to solder it. I always use the blue thread sealer and putting things back together, because all of this hardware is fairly lightweight and there's a limit to how tight you can get it before it just simply distorts or actually breaks. And the blue sealer, once it cures, will keep it nice and tight so that the ordinary, normal, everyday use of a lamp is not going to make it come loose. Now push that wire up in there a little bit, being careful not to push it all the way back in. And with a deep socket and a wrench that some people will recognize, tighten this down, get it nice and snug, and I don't have to
tighten it till it screams, because like I said, I've got the blue goo on it. This is the hickey, a strangely named piece of electrical hardware, which will hold the cap on once it's all put back together.
Now, some people have commented that I spent an awful lot of time building fixtures and jigs for this work.
And when you spend the time to make a clamp that holds a light socket in place, they might have a point. But the Secret Underground Laboratory is a working shop. And anything that makes the job just a little bit easier, like having a helper to help you hold something, that's worth all the time and effort, because I'll probably be ended up doing that again in another day or two, a couple weeks. Now, I give a slightly different version of this sermon in just about every lamp and lighting video. The wire made in the United States for lamps of any kind come with one side of the insulation has ridges on it that you can feel with your fingers, and the other side is smooth. And the reason for that is because each particular wire is supposed to go to a particular place. Strip this back, give them a nice twist. We can see in this particular cable, one side is silver colored, which is actually tin, and the other side is copper. And that corresponds to the socket, where one side has a silver screw and one side has a brass screw. And that's very important. Now, this kind of wire is made of multiple strands, which makes it very flexible and easy to work with. But you can't put multi-stranded wire under screw terminals, against the rules. What they call the National Electrical Code. So before you put any light socket together, the ends of the wires have to be tinned, which means just simply solder is soaked through the wire so that all those multiple strands become one strand. Now with our wires properly tinned, the side with the smooth insulation goes underneath the brass colored screw. And the side with the ridges goes underneath the silver screw. Now there is a safety reason for this, and what it is that the silver screw goes straight to the shell, and the smooth wire and the brass screw goes through the switch. And the way things are made, if the light was missing a light bulb and you're in the dark and you're reaching up in there trying to turn it on and you go and touch the shell, if it's wired properly with that ridged wire on the silver screw, you're not going to get shocked. If it was around the other way, it's a possibility that if you touch an empty socket, you would get a pop or worse. Ordinarily, I'd want to keep the original shells, but we only have one, so that's a strike against it. Also, the cardboard insulators are torn up, cracking, and brittle, and new paper insulators are slightly larger. They won't fit. So what we have is antique bronze shells, and they'll work just fine. Get this up in there. get it snapped down tight. And this will be our new hardware. A little blue thread lock on here. Now ordinarily, it's not a good practice to twist a socket with the wires. But in this case, the wire is free. It's not going to get in the bind, so it's not going to be a problem. And with the blue goo, I can bring it around to where the chain outlet is straight. And I'll have both of them like this, and that will work just fine. Now, one detail that often gets overlooked when wiring lamps is this, which is called the underwriter's knot. And its purpose is to be a stop, so if someone trips over the lamp cord and yanks this down, they don't pull the bare ends out from underneath the screw terminals, which would put them in contact with the steel part, and when you go to pick up the lamp or the whatever it is, you get shocked. And that's a very important piece of safety procedure. Now, when you're making the final connection, you have to make sure that the wire with the smooth insulation on each of the sockets goes to the main power cord with the smooth insulation, because otherwise, you've totally defeated the purpose of trying to get the right wire onto the correct screw terminal. All connections in the Secret Underground Laboratory are made with solder. I don't trust wire nuts, and I certainly don't trust having wires just twisted and then taped together. That is the sign of a purely rank amateur job. After the solder's had a moment to cool, I check to make sure that there's no sharp points on it. And I'm going to cover the connection with shrink wrap, which is a peculiar kind of plastic that, as the name says, shrinks when you get it hot. Take my little torch here. And then watch it shrivel up and pull up tight. And then in a piece of typical Secret Underground Laboratory overkill, I wrap another piece around it, hit it again, and that not only seals the end of it, but also puts a double wrap around the tip of the wire where it's most likely to rub through and cut through. One last bit of assembly with a little bit of improvement. This top cap is made of very lightweight sheet brass, and this stud is how the shade is fastened on. And what happens is when you go to tighten down the shade, this piece caves in, which gets loose, so you tighten it some more, so it caves in again. Eventually it gets down to where it's caved in so far, you can't get it any tighter, and you end up with a wobbly shade. So what I'm going to do is take up that slack space on the inside with this little spacer, and then a brass nut over the stud to hold it all together. And now they can tighten down the shade as tight as they want to, and it won't damage this piece.
This is Bronze Age for the Secret Underground Laboratory Recovery and Salvage, and thank you for sitting through this video. I would really appreciate it if you would click the like button and subscribe. We'll be back again next week with another video. I hope to see you then. Again, thank you.